set to start? I don't know. We're here to figure that out. So are we good to go, guys? Everyone? Yeah. So see, basically what's going to happen is, I'm being absolutely honest about this. Firstly, this is an absolutely unscripted session. And it's not because I want to do something impromptu, because if I really wanted to, I could probably deliver an impromptu 40-minute speech on metaphysics and play around with it. But that's really not what I wanted. The reason why it's unscripted, the reason why this is going to be an absolutely unscripted session, is because I want to dwell into a new nature of inquiry, okay? And see, the title of the speech, Questioning Authority and Freedom, right? All that I want to do with the title is to start engaging a process of inquiry, right? So I start off with a question. So that is and freedom part, and the first part is there's a questioning authority, yeah? And the second thing about this session is, it's not going to be just a one guy speaking sort of a thing, yeah? That's really not going to bear any fruition if it's going to be that way. So what this is going to be is, I want us to collectively together just actually inquire and start speaking yourselves, yeah? I'll probably do a lot of facilitation, but there should be a lot of speaking from your end as well. It cannot be a one-way street, this type of inquiry. It has to be, there just needs to be a lot of focused attention on this question. So I just want to throw this question open to the floor. Please feel free to answer. So when I say questioning authority, so before we begin to even question authority, let's just start using the term authority and let's build from there. So what is authority to you guys? And it can be popcorn style, whatever. Yeah, just go for it. Yeah. Okay.
Authority is somebody who has gained a certain knowledge or understanding of certain matters.
Okay.
By default, authority.
Yeah, so just to pause you on that, I have no authority. We're inquiring together. Yeah. Okay, so please continue. Yeah.
The second one is one that's kind of artificial, like a boss or some like a hierarchical structure of a company, for example. The boss or the manager is not
okay, so a couple of things that were common when you shared with me, and I'm just listening to it fresh without any preconceptions of any of the philosophical theories that I've read for the past 10 years. Something that brings awareness to me is when he said authority, in both cases he used the term figure. There is a person as an authority. So there was something, the term authority is what you associated with a person, with a figure. So there are symbols and figures that we have of authority, right? That is one part of authority. Could we agree? Based on his sharing, what was common amongst both the types? He said one is an authoritative person with amazing knowledge. One is like a boss. It could be a boss. It could even be a policeman. Those are also authority figures.
Appointed authority and the name authority by which.
Yeah, yeah. So, but in both the cases, there is a symbol or an external figure. It's attributed to the outside, right? So, in both the cases, the attribution was to someone out there. Okay, there is a cop out there. There is someone out there. Is authority only something you project out there? Is authority anything else? And one more thing, it's completely okay to be silent for like 2-3 minutes, yeah? It's always good in the spirit of inquiry. Even if there's silence for 2 minutes, be absolutely comfortable with it and just stay with it. Is authority just external? Fabulous. Yep. Fabulous. That's perfect. Yeah, so that's again another form of authority, right? So this is how this spirit of inquiry goes. I had no script, nothing, and he comes up with another, two people come up with two different perspectives on authority, and now we merge them and we see. So one facet of authority, the authority figure out there, the rules, the law, the everything, that is one facet of authority. And it's not just external. There's also another factor, your own factors, your own beliefs, your own ways of this is how it should be, right? That's also a belief, right? So there is the internal, right? So there are both the facets of authority, yeah? So is there any correspondence between the two? I'm just curious. I don't know. And do you see any correspondence between the two? Acceptance. Okay, can you tell us more, sir? Fabulous, right? That you do you know what a deep metaphysical point that you're making? It's a very very deep point that you're making. Any authority whatsoever, wherever it goes, there can be no authority without your acceptance. And that doesn't mean acceptance. Does that mean accept? So there is acceptance, right? So there are so many religious leaders, business leaders, political leaders, all of them, that's the external facet of authority. But isn't there also another facet of authority that can also get reinforced by acceptance? So one level you accept the leader, that's the accept the rule of law, everything, that's the external part. But isn't there also acceptance of the other way? Can we inquire inside? And can any of you share? And just stay in the inquiry. Okay, so at one, see, we've broke up authority into two parts. Yeah, what there is the external, two facets rather, they're not two separate parts. Yeah, one facet is the figures out there, the laws, everything, and in internal authority is your own beliefs, your own conditioning, etc., etc., etc. So when I asked what is it that makes them correspond, he gave the term acceptance, in terms of accepting the external authority. But is acceptance also valid in terms of the internal authority? Yeah, can you just tell me how? Can you share in any way?
Let's take religion as an example.
Okay.
You believe in a supreme entity.
Exactly.
And you accept that it is there without having any evidence for it. That is acceptance.
Yeah. No, but then so
I rely on that authority.
Okay, so just one just to break you outside. I am talking about internal, right? So belief in a supreme entity is still an external projection. I totally agree with what you're saying. There's no fault. But when you're saying I believe in an external authority, that's still a projection outside. I'm trying to and this outside we're probably adepts at dealing with. In usual terms in life, our inquiry is beautiful. We always see the outside, the visible. But I'm just trying to invite all of you to switch it backwards. Try to take it inward. The same thing about acceptance. How can you relate that to your inward authority in terms of your beliefs, in terms of your conditioning, in terms of whatever the whole phantasmagoria of factors? Yeah?
He likes to push a lot of things to a set of people, so it kind of makes him kind of accept the whole other.
Beautiful. So does that give that person security? Does authority give a person sense of security?
He feels sense of security. Security.
But if you go deep and say that. It is not the case, actually.
Beautiful. That is again a really fantastic point, and I could not have rehearsed this. Yeah. So when we're looking at this, see, authority, whether it's internal or external, right? So in terms of internal authority, it's in terms of your daily beliefs. I believe in this, or this should be this way, and there are a lot of environmental factors. Yeah. This is actually a very complex problem, right? 40 minutes is maybe good for us to just be in the spirit of inquiry, but there's this whole complex problem, right? So we're just there are just too many factors involved in this. So can we just take 2 minutes to just, I don't know, hold, sure. No, I'm not talking of them as two separate things. They're just two separate facets, and I'm just playing around with it so that we can try and see a new kind of perspective, trying to catalyze something more holistic.
An internal authority or whatever, in the sense that any thought that you have itself is something external, because you are different from your thought in some ways.
Beautiful.
That doesn't seem to be anything with respect to you.
Yeah. So, you know, the Eskimos, right? The word thought in their language is always external, right? If you actually look really deep, and every thought that goes is, for them, it's actually, when these Eskimos use the word thought, thought was seen as projection, right? So the thought of that out there, there is that projection. So yeah, you can continue with what you were saying.
No, so basically what I would like to argue is that isn't something called an internal authority as such. So every authority is basically an idea or a concept or a thought. And a thought is independent of any person or any thing as such. So it's something which exists eternally throughout any thought. So it really doesn't have something to do with a person. So it's just that you subscribe to a thought and you can unsubscribe to a thought. So I do not know if we can really try to look into it as two different facets.
They are not two different facets. I am just looking at two different attributes of the same thing, right? They are not two completely different facets. So whenever you speak of something internal, there's always the corresponding of the external, right? Yeah?
True.
Yeah. So, and like I said, we're always adepts at looking in terms of outwardness. Can we shift the tide and see the movement? See, what are you experiencing right now in terms of authority? When I keep saying authority, what does it come? What comes to your mind?
Very authoritative person. I'm a very authoritative person. I'm a commanding person. Make sure I'm accountable for a particular action for which I should be authoritative.
Yeah, but aren't you also an authority unto yourself as well? Can you think of some ways where you are an authority unto yourself? See, like now, still so far, what we've been doing is thinking of authority. I'm trying to help you guys see the complete picture. Can you see the authority that's within as well? This way. You want me to probe and explain some more? So, for example, I have a belief. I'm an absolutely amazing guy at this task, okay? I am brilliant at it. Who's saying I'm brilliant at it? Me, right? So I am the authority saying I am brilliant at this. Whether or not that's the fact, I am the authority telling myself that I'm brilliant at it.
But how would you get that feeling? If suppose you're good at playing cricket, so many people around you must have said to you are good at it.
So that's what you're trying to understand. What you're trying to understand is, see, the thing is, there are a lot of factors which inside you, which say that you are good at a lot of things. But the thing is, that is why you should feel that you're not good. The thing is, you should look at a lot of the constant process of improvement. So you have to improve on those things. The process will keep on going. That's what I think you're trying to address.
I'm not addressing that, but this is what you are sharing from your point of view, and that's perfectly fine. Yeah.
That's what
Okay. And I want to get back to, like, now that I've tried to give a holistic view, I'm just seeing, trying to give you a holistic view, okay? Another thing about the spirit of inquiry is, when we ask a question, right, stay with the question. Try not jump to an answer. It's okay to have 2-3 minutes of silence, right? Do you feel that we're moving? Do you see some sort of a movement in this whole conversation? Do you see how energy is flowing? Right now, like even in terms of spirit of inquiry, I can feel my energy just be out there. And then I see few guys come in, And it's all happening together, and I have a sense of awareness of all of this, right? And that's the kind of spirit of enquiry. This term authority is just an excuse to dwell into an enquiry, right? To dwell into something really deep. So would any of you like to share, take this forward? Am I striking a vibe with you, anyone? Yeah.
Also endorse that thing. Then okay, yeah. It's a valid comment. Otherwise, I'm bordering on being an eccentric by saying I'm British.
I'm not, another thing about authority here, right? I'm not saying it's good or bad. I'm not condemning it. Nor am I condoning it. All I'm inviting all of us is to just simply see it, right? To see it for what it is. To see it. And authority also means a lot of conditioning, right? So I want to build on sharing that he made. So he said, oh, I am the authority, I am the freaking dude, let me delegate my task, I feel so freaking good, right? So that gives me a sense of security, right? You see that there is a relationship between authority and a yearning for security. We're always, all of us, there's so much yearning, there's always insecurity, angst, blah, go to work, this, that. We're always yearning for security, and we try and latch on to different things, like a role, like a job. Okay, yeah, I am so good, I am a freaking manager, I'm so good. You're trying to find security, but is that secure? That but what's happening is you're always finding, and you had your hand up.
Yeah, so you were making a point about internal authority, right?
Just to correct me, I'm not making any point.
There's
no such thing as internal or external. I'm just trying to look at authority as a whole inward. Yeah? Okay.
Say, you know, it's coming from an external source. But if we have to look inside ourselves, you know, it would be things like if somebody wants to lose weight, I mean, for example, you know, you'd be like, okay, I'm not going to have another dessert. So you are being authoritative in some sense. I have to do this thing, I have to not do that thing. Yeah, I mean, I just wanted to say that when if I have to look inwards, that's how I exercise authority on myself.
Beautiful. So even for external authority to be valid, there has to be inward validation. And at the same time, what we call external authority can be a projection of internal authority. I am so damn good, and I actually go about pushing myself and actually becoming good and trying to project that to the external world, that I am good, I am the authority, and that becomes a projection. Do you see how it works? Right? Do you see the movement, how this functions? So, but my question is this, right? So there are so many authority. There's authority of religion. So people find authority in this religion. But here's the best part. Someone goes to X religion and he says, I am great. Then someone says, okay, there's the religion. He says, no, my religion is Y. I find security. So in this constant yearning for security, do you actually see the chaos? And I'm trying to look at this from a completely historic perspective, right from the inception of things like a nation state. The reason you have a nation is because you yearn for security, right? You're yearning for security, so you create a nation. But what happens when you have a nation? You have wars, correct? Yeah? So in your constant striving for security, do you actually see the chaos unfolding all over you, inside you? You're very much a part of all this?
So the point you're trying to say is...
I'm not trying to say anything, sir. Please share by yourself.
I'm taking it out from anything.
Yes.
We should not strive for security.
I'm not saying there are no...
Ultimately, what we can see from this scenario is, ultimately we are seeing a lot of chaos. So, our whole purpose of security is defeated then again.
Fabulous. So, I wouldn't say in terms of... When I say should not, again, I'm bringing in authority. So, instead of saying should not, the point that you've hit upon is that in this yearning, in this strife for authority, all we ever do is breed chaos. And why do we breed chaos? Because we are yearning for this sense of security, right? Yeah? And why are we yearning for the sense of security? Why?
Okay. It's a kind of social element. So what
what just the animal does in forest is it tries to implement it,
One my question is, man just an animal or has there been some evolution?
He's an animal and he knows to think, that's it. Yeah. He has this evolution for thinking. So the thing is, but what happens is, in this process, sometimes man stops thinking also and he tries to be an animal. So he tries to impose his own thing also. That's where.
Yeah, but do you see the imposition of will is also stemming from this yearning for security and therefore insecurity? So insecurity is a fact. And none of us try to deal with it. Do we? Do any of us deal with the fact of insecurity? Do we try? Do we even accept? Right? When I'm inquiring, I'm trying to look at just simply look at what is, right? When you notice in terms of striving for security, what is, yeah? Like what is can just be this beautiful tree blowing in the wind. It's just what is, right? But when you're striving for security, you're fighting. You're saying the authority in you says this should not be. You better not come into my, you do not cross that line. That should not be. And you're simply resisting what is. There is no line there. That's all that there is, right? How can you find security in your nation state, in your beliefs, in anything? Is there real security in any of this, right? When is there security? So we've been talking about authority, security. Now let's shift the, we've talked about authority. What is authority? We've questioned it. So now let's inquire, when is there security? Pardon? Beautiful. Yeah, when you don't feel the need for security, you're simply in what is. Do you feel liberated now? Do you feel liberated when you made the statement? And here's the beautiful part of what is, right? I'm trying to facilitate a session here. Here's one person who seems to be connect. And then there's also a lot of disconnect. Not everyone is connecting at the same pace. But I'm still not unnerved. I'm simply accepting what is. Yeah? I'm still flowing. And I'm still inquiring. And I'm still inviting. Yeah? Okay, sorry to interrupt you, sir. What I'm saying is I'm not condemning authority, right? There are certain forms of authority that we do need to work with. Like, say your road has a freaking speed limit, and you've bought like a really cool car, and you're just ripping across the street. Oh, I don't give a shit about authority. You're going to cause a whole lot of damage, right? So I'm not condemning authority. All I'm asking you is to question, where is authority relevant? Where is it irrelevant? In every facet of your life. And do you see the kind of questioning I'm doing? I'm not bringing in preconceived thoughts. I'm not bringing in preconceived notions. So when you're having all this constant incessant thinking, there's a lot of dissipation of energy. And especially when you're really tense, you feel really tired, right? But when you're really fresh, isn't there a sense of attentiveness? So all I'm doing is just focusing my entire faculty, I'm just being attentive on this question. Yeah? Am I connecting? And it's okay, it's completely okay if I'm not connecting also. Pardon? Exactly. I'm not talking about security. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. See, yearning for security, again, it is relative, right? And that relativeness causes a hell of a lot more chaos too, right? And that's and all this security, if you delve really deep into it, isn't it false? Isn't there something really fake about it? Sir, I've seen you writing a lot. Can you share something? Any of your thoughts? That's fine.
This whole thing about, I may think that I am a billion, but unless there is some kind of validation testing process, by virtue of in this network, you are a billion, or in this country, you are a billion, right? But if you look at a worldwide concept, a worldwide test, I wouldn't make it. In India, I'm the cleverest man. I go to Denmark, and they see you did not even speak our language, you did not even able to take our test. So if you are not taking our test, you are not living.
Yeah, anything else? I see you've written a lot. Yeah, so when you say, when you stop yearning for security and the stop the wanting, the needing, right? Isn't that, didn't you get that, experience that at this immediate, and did you feel, do you see the immense sense of freedom you get when you're just, when you're willing to drop all of this? I'm not saying, when I say drop, I don't mean condemn, let it go, kick it, forget it, man, I'm not saying that. See, there are times where it is relevant in certain factors like jobs, this, that, the functional authority is required. I'm just saying questioning. And when I say leave, when I say drop authority, right, here's the thing, okay, you do really well at work. In one day, absolutely fine, or you do really badly, okay? Either way, you're coming back home, alright? And when you are coming back home, isn't your thought still rambling on, oh, I did so well, oh, I did so badly? In that context, it's really not required, right? And all that is coming from a sense of yearning of security. So if we just see it, like, you know, all he did was see it for what it is. It's not a Herculean task. It's not of letting go, it's not a doing. All he did was see it for what it is. All he did was see, okay, I just see we're all just yearning for security and this is causing chaos. And in the very fact of seeing, he says, so there is no security in any of this. And so if I just am what it is, I'm free, correct?
So I have this question
for you.
Sure.
I'm just using authority as a means to delve into an inquiry, right? I'm trying to get you to see what I see now.
Freedom are totally opposite to each other. That's what I feel.
Okay.
So, are you talking about questioning of authority and freedom? That's totally freedom. It's totally different. Are you talking about questioning of authority and freedom? That's what I'm telling you.
Okay. I'm just inquiring, man. I'm just questioning. That's all. I'm just questioning with a fresh mind. I'm not questioning. I don't have any preconceived answers. So if you want, we can deal with this question right now, right here, and without any preconceived thought, and just see for what it is. So you're saying, are you saying authority, freedom is the absence of authority?
Yeah.
Fabulous. That seems like really good insight to me. Does it?
One thing I could relate to, it's more like I live the way I want from morning to evening. So none of the external factors is going to.
But here's another thing, okay? When I live the way I want, I still am this authority, right? So
it's not about want. This again, want stems from insecurity. Yeah, I'm not saying I'm perfect. I'm Buddhahood. I don't have wants. I'm still dealing with all of it, but all I'm saying is this. So even when you say I live like I want, you're still being the authority saying this should be, and you're not accepting what is as it is, and you're not feeling the freedom. And Lexi, for example, I'll give you this story, okay? There was this, have you guys heard of Chuangzi? Zhuangzi, okay, he was a Chinese philosopher, okay? So he was like into the whole movement of Taoism, okay? So he always talks about this whole question of flexibility, and he basically preaches this sort of a, it's just like a fable of truth, okay? So there is this guy called Confucius, okay? Confucius is this guy is taking this side, but Zhuangzi didn't take any sides. That all came because of his followers. So Confucius sees some dude, and he's jumping into a whirlpool, okay? And he's absolutely aghast. And he's like, man, should we go rescue that guy? Should we do anything? And all that. And later he sees that guy come out right off the other side of the whirlpool, right? So he goes up to the guy and asks him, what did you do? How the hell did you end up there? Do you have some special technique? Do you see this freedom has nothing to do with the usual cycle of becoming or any technique? It has nothing to do with it. His answer was simple. See, all I did was flow with the water, and in flowing with the water, I could use the water strength to direct myself where I want. And even in the concept of sailing, the sailors can actually use the sail and use the wind to go against the wind itself, and you're still flowing with the wind. So this is a sense of do you get what I'm saying? The sense of complete acceptance of the flow of everything as it is, and as you flow with it, do you even connect to what I'm talking about? Any of you? And it doesn't have to be an intellectual connection. It can just be some spark somewhere. That's a start, right?
My thing is, the very fact that I have a problem itself wells from the yearning of, why would you have a problem? You'd only have a problem when you're yearning for security, right? See, if you're completely surrendering to what is, and when I say surrender, I don't mean a meek surrender, and you're flowing, it's a dynamic seeing, and you're flowing with it, okay? Yeah? Is there any sort of resistance? When you have a problem, there's always tension, there's conflict, there's resistance. But in this dynamic acceptance of the flow, there is no such tension. So the word problem comes in only when there's resistance.
It has nothing to do with this freedom, right?
In a sense, it's okay. When you're talking about
flowing, those are just analogies, man. No, don't take them literally.
Exactly. I mean, it looks kind of good, but...
The fact is,
not all sea, it's all murky water.
Yeah.
So it's like you really can't.
But even the murky water does settle, right? Whatever mud there is, the muddy water eventually settles down. All you have to do is let the muck. I completely agree with you, but you just have to let the muck settle. And when you accept what is as it is, the muck just settles. Again, here's a beautiful problem, right? The moment you ask how, you're again going through the process of cycle and becoming. You're trying to make absolute effort into some beautiful technique or the other. But the fact is this, right? There is no particular technique to get there. Like a lot of philosophers, a lot of leaders have said, I've invented this technique. Then here's a conflict guy. Oh, I've invented this technique. My technique is better. There's again. Chaos breeds again, and all the sense of freedom that you've achieved has gone. I'd like to also, I'm not saying technique is bad, by the way. It has relevance in the many contexts. I'm just questioning. Yeah.
The way of getting this is actually not in asking why, you know, because like, I mean, not in asking
God, how.
I am half Indian, half Swiss, and I spend most of my life on the Switzerland is
very organized country, you know, you have traffic lights and
everybody knows their place, you know, something. And in India, nobody respects traffic lights, and traffic works actually
better here than it works in a place like Switzerland. Because there are less deadly accidents here per capita than there is in Switzerland. And I think it's because nobody gives a shit. And because you're actually going with the flow of things without even thinking that you're going with
okay, but when I say going with the flow of things,
I didn't say don't negate thinking. There are places, there are contexts where going with the flow of things, it makes absolute sense to think. Like when you stop at a red light, yeah, bring your thought out, people.
As if you're in a bubble and everything around you is pushing or pulling you. You're flowing with the traffic.
This is the way it goes.
This is the way it goes. You're maybe 2 centimeters away from the
bubble. Okay.
You're always
so here's, the you asked me for a technique of freedom, right? Drive in India. You have your technique. You're going with the flow.
But in a country where you have, you know, for example, where it says when it's green, you have the right to go, then you completely lose the sense of thinking. And you're going to go whether it's green or not. And
oh yes.
So
I don't know if I can answer it, but I'll try my best. Yeah? I'm not an
author. So the thing is, so what happens when your thought process is like this, and in your society or something, your thought process is like that, so you learn from freedom and all these things. All the people around you, they are totally thinking the opposite. So what will happen if you kind of be isolated, right? Don't you feel like that?
Not really. I'll tell you why, okay? I'll just give you another...
See, the thing is, the problem is...
But again, one more thing, when you're saying you're isolated, doesn't that give you a sense of uneasiness? When you're saying isolation, again, that's coming from a sense of uneasiness.
Yes.
Correct?
I agree with that. See, the thing is, if you are alone, that is fine.
My question to you is this: you're saying family, right? In regular familial relationships, don't you see a lot of tension? This. You know, listen. Can I just complete? You see the whole clash. Now, if there's one, and you see the dynamic that's going chaos. Okay, family, from all different directions, chaos. Now, one person is clear. He's dropped it. Do you see what it does to the energy dynamics? Just one person who's free. He can make. Do you see the amount of vitality in terms of the energy dynamics of all there is that it can make? You know, family is a small unit. Yeah, you start with the family and then it goes. Is that answered your question in some way?
See, I have a lot of ideas. So, what happens if the person is detached? I think it kind of impacts both the family.
No. When he's detached, like I said, right? Detached, when in the context of responsibility, that detachment doesn't mean you shrug your responsibility. Detachment is just a state. It's a state of absolute freedom. It has nothing to do with that external. It has nothing to do with time, space. It has none of that. It's just an absolute sense of freedom. It has nothing to do with that. I've tasted that, but of course I always get sucked back in, and that back and forth movement is there, but it has nothing to do with time. And it has nothing to do with all the external stuff. It's just bliss. And that bliss, like you've seen how authority is getting projected, so the inward bliss gets projected. The external can also fall in place. And there is no how, what, when. We just flow with what is. You're not second-guessing nature. You're not second-guessing the universe's wisdom, right?
See, in the historical context also, I can see a lot of things. See, the thing is, people who actually spoke the same language, the way you're speaking,
I know, I've heard of him.
So the thing is,
he got persecuted. So what?
He
got
persecuted. The thing is, see, he wrote a lot of poems and all those things.
Okay.
But the thing is, what happened is his personal life was a disaster. He may not consider it as a disaster, but the people, his family, his daughter,
But
how much enjoyment he had with him.
Right? Okay, see. I know. Sir, you're saying this from your reverence of that guy.
Right.
But I don't know if that guy would have your perspective.
That's
correct?
It.
Yeah. Okay, and may I just try and address one more point before we close this? Or what's the time like?
5:10.
Okay, so I'll just quickly address one quick question. Just another way of seeing for holistic perception, right? The question is this, okay? And I may get confused while framing it, and I'm absolutely cool with it, okay? So let's go with it. So the question is this. Can you see the past from now rather than see today from the past? Can you see the past from now rather than see today from the past? I'm just leaving the question open. No. Can you see the past now rather than seeing now as an accumulation of the past?
Because you
have to go in the frame of mind.
Yeah, yeah, beautiful. You know, when you said very difficult, I think my question has done its job. I've absolutely smashed your usual linear way of looking at things, right? Did it shock you a little, the question? You're saying it's very difficult. There's an immediate resistance because it's your usual linear way of thinking, correct? Isn't there an immediate resistance? My question is simple. Today, now, is now just a collection of the past, right? When I'm right now, where is the past? Our usual linear way of thinking and all our conditioning, all our conflict is based on that projected view of this is Zark. But when you're really there, right here, right now, the past is the past really existent in the now? And I'm just seeing a different way of, just another way of seeing. I'm not saying linear is wrong. Linear is beautiful in certain respects, like engineering feats, beautiful things, man. Linear does have its place. But for that to be the sole way of looking at it, does that make sense? Do you see the immense freedom you have now? You can play, like, you're not always the past. You're there, you're embracing what is. It's not projected. It's really not projected. And you can see everything for what it is. You can even see the past right now for what it really is. And that's what happens in the healing, right? When a lot of these people, a lot of these masters and enlightened guys who go, they go through such a process of healing when they get this type of a shift in perspective. And it's almost an instantaneous seeing, but we call it a process because words are inadequate. This thing, the word is not the thing. The thing is the thing, and I call it the mic, correct? So in terms of inadequacy, in terms of things like this, freedom, we give it the connotation of a process. But it really isn't. Just a beautiful freedom, sense of letting go. Do you guys, any of you have to share anything before we wrap this up?
From the point of view, I mean, it's a different point that I may or may not get the answer.
That's beautiful.
No, but I want to know what is the question. I mean, I'm not really able to get the question.
Okay. Okay, my handwriting sucks, so let me just talk. But that's okay, I'm actually cool with my handwriting. See how
freedom, you resisted.
Okay, let's leave with this question. Leave in a state of inquiry. Please take a good shot at this. This is like an absolute DM. Beautiful closing here.
I have to think about this one.
That's beautiful. That's absolutely beautiful.
It's really simple actually. Ask for now is history and whatever you're seeing now from the past is what you're trying to answer.
Not really.
It's not that case. It's not a simple thing.
Yeah, it's not simple. I'll leave you the riddle. Inquire. And here's the thing. Try and use the spirit of inquiry or enquiry. Don't try it. You'll get immediate thought responses just like this. But try and give your complete holistic. Did you see some?
When you actually said.
Sorry, can I just?
Let me complete. Okay. When you just said you did not have the answer of how the money water settles.
How does it settle?
Simple, in a peace.
In a peace?
Yeah,
in a peace.
Exactly.
Yeah. But isn't that another immediate response? Immediate response from thought? Is it not? Okay. Are you feeling blissful?
Yes.
Beautiful. Yeah. All right. Thank you, guys. Yeah.